I believe that. I believe that. Our Adventist pioneers were specialists of prophecy. And when they produced their first fundamental set of beliefs, they included prophecy, and they believed it was a very important part of our, not only heritage, but being as Adventists. And their fundamental principle number 7 of those original fundamentals was called chains of prophecy. And I want to talk about that. Because now, some of you have heard of a man by the name of Leroy Froom, I'm sure. He wrote a book called Movement of Destiny. And I thought about that. I like the title. I don't like all the books. But this truly is a movement of destiny. Destiny has been defined as the events that will necessarily happen to a particular person or thing in the future. Something that's going to happen in the future. You know what that sounds like to me? It sounds like prophecy. It sounds like prophecy. But that's right. Not just simply a movement of destiny. We are a movement of prophecy. We are a movement of prophecy. Now, in 1872, we published a tract on the fundamental beliefs that were, at that time, current and unanimously held by the Seventh-day Adventist people. And it said that the world's history from specified dates in the past, the rise and fall of empires, and chronological success of events down to the setting up of God's everlasting kingdom are outlined in numerous great chains of prophecy, and that these prophecies are now all fulfilled except the closing scene. And I also noted that this was published in 1872 at the Quorum Signs of the Times that Elder James White published. In fact, it was the very first issue ever published of the Signs of the Times, and they included these fundamentals, including this one on chains of prophecy. But they believe that the rise and fall of empires, and we talked last night, we began to study on the rise and fall of empires last night, beginning there with Babylon, Medo Persia, Greece, Rome, the divisions of the Roman Empire, finally the kingdom of Christ, that these are recorded not just simply in Daniel 2, but in other places in the scriptures, and that these constitute what we call chains of Bible prophecy. And they're almost all fulfilled, they wrote in 1872, the closing scene. Now, if they could write that in 1872, what would we say today? Are we even a little closer? We better be closer, beloved. We are much closer. Now, there's another statement that was made, and it deals with the place and study of prophecy. And this was also published in the 1889 1905 and 1917 1914 yearbooks of the Adventist Church. Now, you need to understand that in 1906, and prior to this time somewhat, you had the Kellogg crisis going on. And the reason this statement was not published in the yearbook during those years was that there was no statement published in the yearbook. But every year that we had a yearbook, that we published the statement of fundamental beliefs, up to 1914, we had a statement on the place of prophecy and the study of prophecy. And it says this, that prophecy is a part of God's revelation to man, that it is included in that scripture which is profitable for instruction, and that it is designed for us and for our children, that, so far from being enshrouded in impenetrable mystery, is that which especially constitutes the word of God, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. That a blessing is pronounced upon those who study it, and that consequently it is to be understood by the people of God sufficiently to show them their position in the world's history and the special duties required at their time. What happened in the year 1915? Mr. White died, didn't he? That's right. Now, not only did we have a statement that dealt with chains of prophecy, not only did we believe in this principle of the place of the study of prophecy, but we also had a very firm, clear understanding of who the man of sin was. And we even had a fundamental about it, fundamental number 13, that as the man of sin, the papacy, has sought to change times and laws, the laws of God, Daniel 7:25, and has misled almost all Christendom in regard to the fourth commandment, we find a prophecy of a reform in this respect to be wrought among believers just before the coming of Christ. You know, verse 5, 56, 1 Peter 1, 5, Revelation 14, 12, etc. This statement is also signs of the times of Torah, and also in the yearbook. So we believe that there were chains of prophecies, important study prophecies. The prophecy told us that the papacy was the man of sin. Have you read the current fundamental statements that Adventists have published since that time? Well, I want to read to you the current statement on the place of the study of prophecy in the Bible. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. Do you realize that there is no fundamental statement about the place of prophecy, the importance of studying prophecy in the Bible? Well, there surely must be something about the man of sin. So let's read that statement. Here's the current statement on the identification of the man of sin. It's blank too. Did you realize that? Did you realize that if you are today a Seventh-day Adventist in good and regular standing, which means that you fundamentally agree with those principles, those 28 fundamentals now, that you do not have to believe in the importance of prophecy, and you do not have to believe in the papacy of the man of sin. You don't have to believe that Sunday keeping will become the mark of the beast either, because that's not part of our fundamental belief. There's no need for a Sabbath reform anymore because we don't believe in the papacy anymore. We don't believe that there's a mark of the beast anymore. Not in our fundamental sense. Not at all. And so I just put this note in here. So one is not required to believe anything about the man of sin. The papacy originally is important to prophecy to be a Seventh-day Adventist and good and regular standing in the church. And I ask you a question. If this is not apostasy, what is apostasy? What does the word apostasy mean? It comes from a Greek word that means a falling away. A falling away. If I was to say the Baptist Church has had apostasy about the mark of the beast, that wouldn't be correct because they've never understood the truth about the mark of the beast. They've never had that truth to fall away from it. So we as a people have had such great life of it. We've had the truth on these points. And today, we don't need to redefine these points today. The mark of the beast is exactly what we've always taught it to be. It's not homosexuality today, friends. We are living in the Day of Atonement today. This is a prophetic movement that deals with the great prophecy of January 14th. And today, we are living in the atmosphere of the Day of Atonement. Can you say amen? I hope you can say amen today. Now, our Adventist believers, in these early pioneer days, they recognize these fundamental principles of prophetic interpretation. When you think about Bible prophecy, whether it is Daniel or Ezekiel or Jeremiah, but especially Daniel and Revelation, when we call these apocalyptic prophecies, these prophecies that deal with a great deal of symbolism, beasts, dragons, seals, trumpets. We'll hear about some of these things later today. Our Adventist pioneers understood a biblical hermeneutic that is very important. And that is that the way that you study prophecy is from the perspective that this is history being told before it happens, and it is as a scroll that is continually unrolling. So that when we read, for instance, the prophecies of Daniel, and when we read the prophecies of Revelation, those prophecies, for instance, when Daniel told Nebuchadnezzar, "Thou art this head of gold," those prophecies began, for instance, with Babylon.
And so they followed in the path of the Protestant reformers. Do you remember the Protestant reformers? People like Martin Luther, right? Okay. And they believed in a system of prophetic interpretation that today we call historicism. Historicism. That these prophecies began with ancient civilizations, yes, but then they go through the span of time from those civilizations down to the very end of time. So there's some of the past, some of the present, and as we get near the end, a little bit more left of the future, but not much anymore. And that is contrasted today to the more prevalent evangelical Protestant, not Protestant, Protestant views of interpretation. Most of you have heard, and at least if you're an English-speaking person in America, you've heard of what's called the Schofield Reference Bible. Scofield Reference Bible has notes in it that use a system of interpretation called futurism. And futurism was developed by a Spanish Jesuit by the name of Francisco Ribera, who published a commentary, I believe, in 1590, with the idea of making a counter interpretation to the book of Revelation, because the Protestant reformers were all saying that Rome is the beast. The Pope is Antichrist. This is the man of sin. And so the idea is we will write a counter interpretation to that. And we will write an interpretation that takes the onus off of the papacy. And so Ribera came up with this concept called futurism. And futurism said that all these great prophecies of Revelation outside of the first three chapters, which deal with chapters 2 and 3 with the churches of Asia, that these events foretold all happen in the future, way in the future. And if they happen way in the future, then the papacy, which is today, can't be the Antichrist. It can't be the beast power. And this is the method of interpretation that most Protestant churches today use in studying the book of Revelation. There was another Jesuit, and his name was Alcazar. And he came up with something called preterism that says that all those prophecies were fulfilled in the first century, or for the most part. In the first century, Nero was the beast, or one of the Roman emperors was the beast power, and so on. But either way, it takes the onus off of the Catholic Church. That was their purpose. But Adventist people realized that those were not good ways to interpret the Bible, because the Bible itself doesn't teach us to interpret it that way. And so we had brethren who recognized these principles and wrote accordingly. And I want to share with you this morning some of their testimony briefly. D.T. Bordeaux, in Sanctification or Holy Living on page 13, wrote, "It would not be necessary to enter into a lengthy argument to convince the candid that we are living in the last days. By comparing the sure word of prophecy with history and the signs of the times, we see clearly that we are occupying that last link in those great chains of prophecy which were to reach to the end, that the leading signs which were to be the precursors of Christ's second coming and which were to bring us to the last generation." Now notice that it says that last link in those great chains of prophecy. And so Bordeaux understood that there were chains of prophecy. He went on and said, let me just finish, he says, that were to bring us to the last generation have been fulfilled, and that the present signs of the times show conclusively that the great drama of this world's history is about to wind up, and that the Lord is near even at the door. And says, see the works of the prophecy of Daniel and the signs of the times published at the Review and Herald office, D.T. Bordeaux. And so he says, we believe this. You can study this out. This is what we publish. Uriah Smith said, and this is in Daniel and Revelation, page 5, "In no portion of the Word of God is this, referring to the increase of prophetic knowledge, more apparent than in the books of Daniel and Revelation, and we may well congratulate ourselves on this, for no other parts of that word deal so largely in prophecies that pertain to the closing scenes of this world's history. No other books contain so many chains of prophecy reaching down to the end. In no other books is the grand procession of events that leads us through to the termination of prophetic time and ushers us into the realities of the eternal state so fully and minutely set forth." And that is the chains of prophecy, especially in Daniel and Revelation. Smith also said, continuing, "No other books embrace so completely, as it were in one grand sweep, all the truths that concern the last generation of the inhabitants of the earth, and set forth so comprehensively all the aspects of the time, physical, moral, and political, in which the triumphs of earthly woes and wickedness shall end and the eternal reign of righteousness begin. We take pleasure in calling attention especially to these features of the books of Daniel and Revelation, which seem heretofore to have been too generally overlooked or misinterpreted." And again, that was by Elder Uriah Smith in Daniel and the Revelation. Have you ever heard of E.J. Wagoner? Have you ever then heard of J.H. Wagoner, Joseph Harvey Wagoner? Who was he? The father of E.J. Wagoner, right. And he was one of our strong pioneers. And here's something that he wrote after commenting on Daniel chapter 2 and verse 30. He said that the world's history from specified dates in the past, the rise and fall of empires, and the chronological succession of events down to the setting up of God's everlasting kingdom are outlined in numerous great chains of prophecy. And these prophecies are now all fulfilled except the closing scenes. Now notice Elder Wagoner made a statement here concerning numerous great chains of Bible prophecy. Not just one, but numerous chains of Bible prophecy. And that's from his book, From Eden to Eden, page 74. In another reference, refutation of the doctrine called the age to come on page 23. He said, closely connected with the great prophetic outlines or chains of prophecy, we find many explicit statements of the determination of the Lord concerning the people and the nations of the earth. Now notice these two statements that are in gold here and here. It says great prophetic outlines or chains of prophecy. So they were understanding that these, what they called chains of prophecy, were simply the outlines of the prophetic events that were going to come. And that there were several of them. It wasn't just in one place that we would find these events. He also wrote, the book of Revelation consists of several lines or chains of prophecy reaching to the same point, to wit, the coming of Christ. By considering the relation of the various links of the chains to that event, we may easily discover the parallels in each. The vision of the sounding of the trumpets reaches to the coming of Christ, chapters 11, 15 through 19. Chapter 14 reaches to the same time and embraces the same events revealed in chapter 11, verses 15 through 18. So Wagoner is saying that these chains of prophecy, they all seem to culminate in one great place. And what is that place that they culminate in? The coming of Jesus Christ. And are we near the coming of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Watch, you saints. Watch, ye saints, because the Lord's coming soon.
Amen.
Elder James White, and I'd like to say that we had many, many great men in our early movement, but I don't think anyone stood as tall as James White. James White bore burdens that we will never know anything about. He said, the book of Daniel contains chains of prophecy which reach down to the end of earthly kingdoms and the judgment. Chapters 11 and 12 are one chain, reaching down to the time when Michael shall stand up, the time of trouble such as never was, and the resurrection of many. Chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And then he continues. In verse 6, one says to the man clothed in linen which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall be the end of these wonders? The end of the wonders is the close of these scenes connected with the judgment. In the next verse, the answer is given by the man clothed in linen with a most solemn oath, with both hands raised to heaven. But, says Daniel, I heard, but I understood not, then said, I, O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? Verse 8. The prophet here makes earnest inquiries relative to the scenes connected with the second advent. Read the angel's reply, go thy way, Daniel, for thy words are closed up and sealed to the time of the end. Verse 9. The prophecy of Daniel, which points distinctly to the period of the second advent, was closed up and sealed till the time of the end. And that's from James White, Bible Adventism, page 73. So connected with this climactic point of the second coming of Christ, Elder White is bringing in, from the book of Daniel, the judgment also. And remember, Jesus says that when he comes, his reward is with him. The judgment has to occur before Jesus can come. Welcome this morning. I'd also like to share with you another statement from James White, and this is also from Life Incidences on page 47. It is characteristic of the different chains of prophecy that each succeeding one introduces particulars not furnished in any previously given. The seventh of Daniel, after covering the general field symbolized by the image of chapter 2, instructs us more particularly concerning the development of the little horn or man of sin. And so what he's saying is you have these different parallel chains of prophecy. And they start out fundamentally basic, but then they become more detailed as we go through. And he says in particular, chapter 7 helps us to identify the man of sin, which in chapter 2 is really not mentioned at all. He continues, in the 8th chapter, we are again conducted over a portion of the world's great highway with additional peculiars concerning the mighty kingdoms that stand as waymarks along our journey. In Signs of the Times, a booklet, not the magazine, on page 24, Elder White also wrote, "While the book of Daniel has to do with four universal monarchies, Babylon, Persia, Grecia, and Rome, and its several chains of prophecy bring us with wonderful definiteness to the day of God, the second coming of Christ and the last judgment, the book of Revelation pertains to the fourth. Rome and its several lines of prophecy bring us down with equal minuteness to the same point and open before us the naked glare of eternal scenes." These were some of the leading men in our movement. And they were speaking well for the movement. Today, you don't have to believe anything about prophecy to be a Seventh-day Adventist. And I asked a question earlier. I said, if this is not apostasy, what is? But I want to take it a step further. This is not simply apostasy. This is an apostate church. An apostate church is the one that lessens the distance between itself and the papacy. Elder White said those things. Now, Uriah Smith also chimed in a little bit more on this. I'd like to read you something he wrote in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald. And I want you to notice the date of this. December the 11th, 1856. And what we're going to read, it was written in published in 1856 by Uriah Smith. "The great object of the book of Revelation seems to be to show the Christian traveler his whereabouts on the highway of time. This is faithfully done by the many chains of prophecy in that book, which span the period of the fourth universal empire. Thus we have line upon line, that the highway may be definitely marked, each link in these prophetic chains answering as a way mark." And so they recognized these principles early, friends. It didn't take them long at all. Elder J.N. Loughborough, he also spoke to this. He says, "Now admitting that the book given by the Father to the Son was the book of the future, and that these events contained in that book were kept secret till the book was opened, the next question would be, where and when began the breaking off of those seals? You will probably answer, where John had the vision recorded in chapter 6. But if that was the case, the events of the first seal were still closed up after they commenced to have their fulfillment." And then he said, "The events of the first seal are applied by most commentators as having their commencement with the commencement of the gospel church, when that church went forth in power, their mission being attended by signs, divers miracles, and gifts of the Holy Ghost, and they, as represented by the rider on the white horse, went forth conquering and to conquer. But what happened at the time of the giving of this vision that should prevail with the Father to then and there open the book? That which prevailed with the Father and gave power to the open book was that the line of the tribe of Judah, Christ, appeared in the midst of the four beasts and 24 elders as a lamb slain. We will admit that John had a view of the opening of the first seal as well as the others." And then he goes on. "The events of that seal were then transpiring and were among the things that are, which we understand John was commended to write. I understand that John's mind was carried back to the commencement of this chain of event as his mind was carried back in other chains of prophecy." Loughborough was saying that not only in dealing with the seals, but in the book of Revelation there would be other chains of prophecy. And he says this is for the purpose of shedding light on the prophecy and to give the commencement of those events. It does not necessarily follow, because John had a vision of the opening of those seals, that none of them were opened till he had a view of their opening. Daniel, continuing. "Daniel had a view in chapter 7 of the line, with the other three beasts coming up out of the sea. But we do not conclude from the fact that Daniel had a view of the coming up of the line that Babylon did not rise till Daniel had that vision. But we understand that his attention was carried back to the rise of that kingdom in order that the student of prophecy may have the whole chain before his mind." And then he concludes, "So we understand in the testimony concerning the seven seals, John's attention was carried back to the first link in the chain of consecutive events in order that the chain may be complete." And notice the date, 1857. Again, early in our movement, these things were understood. Well, I have a few more I'd like to share. Uriah Smith also. And this is from 1857 also in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald. From the consideration thus far offered, it is evident that this government, the United States of America, in both of its leading principles, republicanism and Protestantism, is false to its profession. It is a lamb only in appearance. How wonderfully has this nation thus far answered to the symbol, and what feelings should it create in our bosoms as point after point we trace it out and perceive the wonderful harmony. Thus, another link is added to the great chains of prophecy that are leading us down to the end. Another great waymark is set up to show us our position in the world's history, another great evidence that we are right in our calculations of the approaching consummation, and that our hopes and anticipation of a glorious and immediate deliverance of all the faithful are well founded. And even D.M. Canwright, before his apostasy, stated, "Behold, we have numerous chains of prophecy locating the second advent, all terminating within a few years of the present time." That was published in 1864. I.H. Evans, in 1901, in the General Conference Bulletin, speaking at the General Conference session in 1901, said, "Revelation comes and goes as quickly and as surely as the rest. Where are we in these great chains of prophecy? Down in the close of chapters 13 and 14, just between verses 13 and 14 of chapter 6. He recognized that. We've all seen prophetic charts, something like this, of Daniel 2, 7, 8, and I've also seen some, but I couldn't find one when I was doing this that included chapter 11 of Daniel, because most commentators agree that chapter 11 has prophetic parallels also. But in Daniel chapter 2, you have a chain of prophecy. In Daniel chapter 7, you have a chain of prophecy. Daniel 8, which includes also going into chapter 9, there's a chain of prophecy as well. And all these are covering parallel events. Now let's summarize some points here. The chains of prophecy link history from specified points to the judgment and the coming of Christ. That's where they're pointing toward the judgment and the coming of Christ. The biblical chains of prophecy help us to know where we are at in the end of time. When you're driving from one place to another, you want to know where you're at. And we're on our trip to heaven, friends, and we need to know where we're at. And the prophecies God has given us help us to understand that. Daniel and Revelation contain many chains of prophecy, but we also see chains of prophecy in Matthew chapter 24, 2 Thessalonians 2, among other places. Each succeeding chain of prophecy introduces particulars not furnished in any previously given. In other words, we're looking for additional content, additional details. The chains of prophecy in Revelation begin with the fourth kingdom of the chain, and that is of Daniel, and that's Rome in both pagan and papal places. And sometimes these chains reveal events in the past. And you remember Loughborough was speaking about, for instance, when Daniel saw the four great beasts come up out of the sea, and one of those was the winged lion of Babylon, but Babylon had already risen. And so sometimes they make a reference back as well. And so that would be like, for instance, in chapter 7, you have Babylon there given. Now, let's just talk about some of these chains for just a couple minutes, and we're almost out of time. But we'll get here. We have time. In Daniel chapter 2, it begins with the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar, but it ends with Christ's kingdom being set up, right? So that's a chain of prophecy, and it covers thousands of years, doesn't it? In Daniel chapter 7, we also begin with the kingdom of Babylon, and it ends with the saints taking the kingdom and the judgment. In Daniel chapter 8, we now begin with the kingdom of Medo-Persia, but it ends with the judgment, and especially we have the inclusion of the 2300-day prophecy, and I still believe it.
Amen.
In Daniel chapter 11 and 12, we have another chain of prophecy, and this one begins with Xerxes, and it goes down again to the time when Michael stands up. Okay, a lot of detail in Daniel 11 that's not found anywhere else. In Revelation chapter 2 and 3, we have the churches, beginning with the church of Ephesus in Revelation 2:1, the apostolic church, and ending with Laodicea in Revelation 3:14. Ellen White makes an interesting statement I want to share with you concerning this in manuscript release Volume 1, page 372. She says, the names of the churches are symbolic of the Christian church in different periods of the Christian era. The number of the church is 7 indicates completeness and is symbolic of the fact that the messages extend to the end of time and are enforced today. Why the figures used are symbolic of the state of God's professed people, the wheat developing among the tares, truth standing on its own eternal basis in contrast with error. In Revelation chapter 5 and 6, we have it beginning with the apostolic church and ends there in Revelation chapter 6, 14 through 17 and 8:1, and there you have the coming of Christ. We have the chain of prophecy of the trumpets in Revelation 8 through 11. We have in Revelation 12, the great controversy begins with the incarnation and ends there down in chapter 12, verses 16 and 17. The chain of prophecy of Revelation 13 and 14 with the mark of the beast crisis. The beginning is Revelation 13, 1 through 5. The papacy arises from the fallen kingdoms of Rome, and it ends in chapter 14 with the three angels' messages and the judgment being poured out upon those who are rebellious. We're living in these times, beloved. We're living in these times. And we need to recognize this. And I just want to say that there is, not so subtle, but some people might think subtle, attempt to move us away from some of these great chains of prophecy that we have and to radically reorder our faith. I spoke to some of you yesterday morning at a devotional we had. And I mentioned to you that it was Satan's plan to mingle truth with error. And I remember Brother Mac, he gave me a big amen on that. He's shaking his head back there right now. And right now, even among those people who profess to teach the truth about God, there is an attempt to disrupt some of these chains of prophecy and to redefine the mark of the beast, to redefine the Day of Atonement. And beloved, it's a mixing of truth with error. It sure is. And we cannot afford to listen to it, and we dare not promote it. We have a truth. Ellen White said many years ago, we have a truth which admits of no compromise. Then why are we compromising it, I ask? It's time to hold the faith that was once given to the saints, beloved, and to realize that the culmination of these prophecies is just upon us, even now. If there was ever a time that we needed to be hid in Jesus Christ, it's today. The greatest crisis that this world will ever experience is very soon to come upon us. And you know, we've as Adventists, in part of the study of these chains of prophecy, we have emphasized a reform concerning the fourth commandment that was so necessary, right? Mm-hmm. And rightfully so.
Yes.
But people will ask you, people in this corrupt apostate system that is called the corporate Seventh-day Adventist church today, they will ask you, they say, well, where is this thing about the first commandment you're making such an issue about? Beloved, we are told, and I will be reading you the statement on Sabbath, that not everyone who professes to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. Not everyone who claims to believe the truth is going to make it through. This great crisis that is coming, we will know intellectually, but not experientially. And only those people who know their God will be strong and do exploits at that time. Only those people who really are anchored in God are going to be willing and able to stand at that time. Everyone else, friends, is going to capitulate.
Amen.
Yes.
You look at what has happened in the last century in Russia or in Germany, and how the, for instance, in Russia when the Bolsheviks took power, how the church was basically to a great degree dissolved. And during the latter part of the last century, you had a recognized Adventist church in Russia, but it was collaborating with the government.
Yeah.
It was collaborating with the government. And in Germany, in World War II, the Adventist Church was having flags with swastikas out in front. Mm-hmm. And signs, no Jews welcome. Mm-hmm. And I want to tell you, friends, the Adventist people in America are much weaker, much softer than those hard Russian and German people were. Yeah. We're a soft people today. Yeah. We live in such a secularized Adventism today. We don't know what sacrifice and privation are, friends. And when pressure is brought to bear, we're going to chuck it all and go in with the evangelicals and the Catholics. And we need to have an understanding of the processes that are going to happen. But friends, even more importantly, we need to be prepared spiritually. I've thought about this. I can know every prophecy exactly interpreted right. Okay? I might know exactly what the daily is. And I might know who the King of the North is exactly. But if I don't know who Jesus Christ is and I don't have Him living in my heart, it doesn't matter. But I might be confused on some of these prophecies. I know God wants us to understand them, but I might not have every detail right. But friends, if I have Christ right, then when the events happen, I'm going to be able to go through them no matter what they are.
Amen. Amen.
And so it's imperative that we put our lives in the hands of Jesus Christ today.
Yes.
Today is the day of salvation, Paul says. It's not tomorrow. It's not next week. Mm-hmm. Today is the day. Not one of us have a promise of tomorrow. Mm-mm. And not one of us have a promise of even this afternoon.
We don't.
We don't know what can happen. Beloved, I believe with all my heart. I've invested all my life in the Advent message. I don't question it an iota. And I pray that you won't either. And don't let anyone take these great prophecies away from you. Don't let anyone take the preciousness of this message away from you. These prophecies, they center in Jesus. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. Michael's going to stand up soon. And he will have stood for you in the judgment if you have stood for him on this earth. That's what Jesus said. I want to stand for Jesus today, don't you?
Amen.
Amen.
I want Jesus in my life today because I want to be ready for these final events that are just knocking at our door right now. I'd like to invite you to kneel with me as we pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much that you have made us a movement of prophecy. And we of all people of this earth have understood these prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. We've understood how they interconnect and they are chains linking one event with another, bringing us step by step down to the very end of Earth's history. And Father, I believe it's been your purpose and plan to lead each of us step by step into understanding who you are, who Jesus is, that he wants to be our Savior, and that we can step by step walk each day a little closer to you than we did the day before. Yes. But we also realize, Father, that there will be those who will, because of worldly conformity, and that they have step by step walked away from you, walked into the things of the world, that they will not find it a hard matter to accept the mark of the beast. Father, may not one of us be lost here. May we be willing to share this message bluntly, straightly, kindly, of course, with tact, with wisdom sent only from heaven, Father. But may your Spirit attend our work. May your Spirit attend this camp meeting, that we can rightly understand these great chains of prophecy that we're going to be studying this week. And I thank you in Jesus' name. And Father, also, I want to remember Brother Thomas, who's supposed to be speaking on one of these great chains this afternoon. And his voice has been a little quivering, I understand, but I pray that you'll give him healing and strength and touch him. And each one of our speakers that will come, Brother Jean-Christophe, will be speaking after our breakfast break. And help us each, Father, to know you, to love you, and to serve you, and to know where we're at in this time, and to live as though we are living in the time of the final atonement and the investigative judgment.
Amen.
And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.